Good evening and welcome. I am Juan Edghill Jr. Thank you to you, our viewers, especially to those that are tuning in with us for the first time this evening. Thank you for joining us.
Also, thank you to those of you joining us via our Facebook live stream. I'm Roodi Balgobin, and this week we'll be looking ahead as it relates to today's challenges and concerns. And we'll be looking at the impact of this on our nation and the Guyanese people as a collective.
We have a lot to discuss tonight. I am Nalini Singh, so let's jump right into it. But before we get into tonight's program, I would like to remind everyone that we only have 5 days remaining for the claims portion of the claims and objection period. So we're urging all Guyanese voters to ensure that their names are published on the preliminary list of electors. It is also available on GCOM's website. The PLE is printed and posted around at your polling areas. It's available on our Facebook page on a pinned post at the top. Please remember that claims ends on October 4th, 2019. This is your last opportunity to get your name on the list. So these are for people who have turned 18, will turn 18 by December 31st, 2019. It'll also give you a chance to register if you're not on the PLE. For the first time registrants, you need to take with you your original Guyana birth certificate or your valid passport. Once persons check their name during the claims in a objections exercise, they can use this time for various transactions, such as transferring from one voting district that they're living in if you moved. So today we saw the general secretary of the People's Progressive Party went and did his transfer. If you have any questions and you would like these questions answers about the claims and objections exercise, you can contact Freedom House on its hotline numbers 231-1133. 231-5401 and 231-1148. The image is on our screen, but you can also WhatsApp message 611-PPPC, which is 611-7772.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yeah, it's very important that everyone tries to get registered and get on the list, because as you know, the right to vote is a fundamental right, which many have fought and died for. In this country, we've mentioned it many times on this program about the ballot box martyrs and such other persons that were shot and killed for this specific right. So it's very important that you take it takes less than 10 minutes to go into any one of the GCOM polling stations near to you and get these transactions that Nalini highlighted to get them done. Don't forget, as I mentioned earlier, this is a fundamental right of yours, and it's your right to choose whichever government you feel that can better govern Guyana as we, you know, go into a very important part of our history. As everyone knows, we're now becoming an oil-producing nation. I'm sure many youths like ourselves out there would like an opportunity to elect that government which they feel is very competent and capable of running the country, especially where oil and gas is concerned. So, while we've made that point, I'd just like to mention, to make sure that everyone gets on the voters list and that you're able to participate in the democratic process of voting at an election. One of the most important aspects of civic duty lies in your hands, and that is to ensure that all registered voters come out and vote on Elections Day, and to ensure that your names are on the list and that you're ready for Elections Day, which we know is March 2nd, 2020. Now, to get into some of the issues that we've been facing at GCOM and some of the controversial decisions that have been made more recently, early in this week, as a matter of fact, at GCOM, one such decision is the chairperson of the Guyana Elections Commission, retired Justice Claude Singh, voted with the PNC commissioners that thousands of persons who did not uplift their identification cards will have 21 days to uplift those cards, or they will be removed from the official list of electors. However, she noted that those persons will not be removed from the National Register of Registrants. So, that by itself is an illegal act, because we know that the Constitution mandates how a person gets on the list and gets off the list.
Yes.
In fact, Article 59, which is very clear, and for your edification, I'll just like to read Article 59 of the Constitution, which says, and I quote, Subject to the provisions of Article 159, every person may vote at an election if he or she is of the age 18 years or upwards and is either a citizen of Guyana or a Commonwealth citizen domiciled and resident in Guyana. So clearly, removing these persons from the official list of electors would mean that they would not be able to vote at the upcoming elections,
absolutely,
which is, as you can see what I just read to you, is totally illegal.
Well, not only that is illegal, mm-hmm, but it was also said in June 2011 by the then GCOM chairman, mm-hmm, Serge Bali, that 43,187 ID cards were not uplifted. But in that regard, he said, this is not a voter's ID card, mm-hmm, it's a national identification card, which points to the fact that you don't actually need to go uplift it, mm-hmm, to stay on this.
So what we can see here is that it is in contravention to the law.
Mm-hmm.
It is not lawful to take someone off the list. We saw the Chief Justice's ruling, and she would have made the case against residency being a requirement to, mm-hmm, vote at the next election. So once again, it's like it's popping up back again that you're, mm-hmm, urging persons to having to come to Guyana to uplift their ID cards to vote.
Mm-hmm.
But we know that that is no longer a requirement.
Mm-hmm.
So the Chief Justice's ruling actually goes against everything that's said here. And the case, the Estepariur case from 1997,
mm-hmm,
it was this, the current chairperson from GCOM,
mm-hmm,
Chief Justice, Justice Claudette Singh, she had ruled in the Estepariur case that identification cards were not a requirement to vote in the elections.
Mm-hmm.
So we can see here clearly that that this measure by GCOM is not only in contravention to the law, but it breaks best practices and practices that have been conducted at GCOM for a very, very long time.
Mm-hmm. Since
92. Actually, the Chief Justice in a ruling at paragraphs 129 said, and I quote, "The right to be registered to vote and the right to vote are sacrosanct and fundamental. The International Convent on Civil and Political Rights, to which Guyana has acceded and which is incorporated into our constitution, and in our constitution is at Article 154A1 and the fourth schedule of the constitution, establishes the right to vote as a matter of international human right law and provides that every citizen has a right to vote." So what she was saying is, regardless of if you uplifted an ID card, and for points that the points that Juan was making, that it's not a requirement to vote, because their rulings from the court to that effect, their statements from the former chairman of GCOM to that effect, when there were over 43,000 persons who did not uplift these ID cards, you're basically taking away their human, their...
Well, it's in the UN Declaration of Human Rights, too.
Exactly. You're taking away their fundamental right, which is something that Guyana in the Constitution protects against. And Article 159 is one of those such protections. Also, in another decision, the GCOM chairperson rejected the proposal of the PNC-nominated commissioners to highlight the names of eligible Guyanese voters who did not participate in the now-scrapped house-to-house registration on the official list of electors. We know that there was a proposal from the commissioners there, the government-nominated commissioners, to have those persons' names highlighted and placed on the OLE on the day of elections.
Yeah, so this is a very welcome decision because it can lead to discrimination of voters who didn't partake in house to house.
And as we know, it's only 3,000 plus, 370,000 plus persons who did participate in that.
Yeah.
So,
that's
and
well, those are the stats that were presented.
Mm-hmm. And the OLE, the PLE that is currently being scrutinized via the claims and objections has over 650,000 plus persons.
Yeah.
Yeah, so when we talk about discrimination, what we mean is that the presiding officer, which has authority over that specific polling place, polling booth, whatever it is, as you may, what they can do is basically cause an eligible voter,
mm-hmm,
not to be allowed to cast their ballots at the election. And that is something that we are actually guarding against.
Mm-hmm.
So this entire practice of discrimination could occur, but we're trying to guard against it.
Mm-hmm.
We don't want any presiding officer to be tempted to disenfranchise any eligible voter from exercising their franchise at the next elections come March 2nd, 2020.
So over the weekend, it was interesting. We saw GCOM publish the house-to-house registrant list at locations across the country. So the house-to-house registrant list has been published in two parts. Category A is those who are eligible to vote in 2020, and Category B, the smaller list, is those people who were 14 to 18 during the time of registration.
Mm-hmm.
So the problem that we've been observing with this house-to-house list, because we sat down, we've been comparing them against the PLE, is your errors, like the spelling of your name, or like your address is changed, your occupation is changed, which when you're looking on the list as well, there are people that are supposed to be on the PLE that are now appearing on this house-to-house registration. So this is possibly padding. We have to go on the ground and actually go to these houses and check. So this is where we would like we would like you to get involved and check the list, look at the two. If you see a name they don't recognize, you know, flag it, call someone. We have the hotline numbers we listed earlier, so please let us know.
This is a responsibility for everyone.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Basically, we have to be vigilant with this exercise because we have to ensure that not only that eligible Guyanese get the opportunity to vote, but persons who names that are not supposed to be on the list, we have to ensure that they are not on the list.
Exactly.
Because we do not want any rigging to occur next year at the election. So it is twofold, and spelling errors as well, that you rightfully pointed out. So we have to ensure that we're vigilant.
With the many errors on the list, there is no recourse for any voters to fix those errors once if there's a simple mistake in their name or something of the sort. For example, my name is Roodi, and it's spelled R-O-O-D-I. Many persons, when they hear my name, they spell it R-U-D-Y. Now, in an instance where that occurs, there's a statutory process that is laid out of how an election is conducted. You start with the extraction of the names from the NRR, which produces a PLE, and that is subjected to what is called a claims and objections, which we started off the show by telling you about and what can be done during that period. Now, more importantly, after the claims and objections, a PLE is produced, an official list of electors is produced, which is the list that you go to the election with. There's no other mechanism by which you can correct anything, change anything, or make objections to the OLE. That would be the final document that you go into an elections with. Mm-hmm. So for example, if my name is spelled wrong and then I show up to vote with an ID card or without an ID card and my name is in a different format there, then I won't be able to vote, which again would disenfranchise persons.
Yeah.
So that is very important. That is why you need to look at this from now.
Yeah, I do want to make the point though that this house-to-house registrants list, it is not a supplemental list to the PLE. It is not a supplemental list. And secondly, it does not fit into the legal architecture of our constitution and in our country. So this house-to-house registrants list, there's a lot of things that are wrong with it. But persons need to be aware that this is not a supplemental list to the PLE. The PLE is still in place. It is still the main list that we have to be looking at. That is a point I wanted to bring up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so there's many unanswered questions too on this, the data used from house-to-house registration list. So questions that would come up is things like, what will the data be used for? Mm-hmm. How are Guyanese expected to interact with this data? How do addresses of concern about the proposal to merge data with the NRR database, so the National Register of Registrants, how are we merging this? And why a published list when the publication is essentially legal? It doesn't fit with our legal architecture. So if your name is spelled wrong on the house-to-house one, what happens there and so on? Like, I think you were mentioning.
Exactly. Over the weekend, the GCOM was instructed, the secretariat made a decision through the CEO, Mr. Lowenfield, to go ahead and publish these lists around the country. And so the party chief scrutineer, Mr. Zulfikar Musfar, wrote to him. Today there has been no answer from him. So on the 26th of October 2019, and I'd read a part from the letter that was sent to Mr. Lowenfield. Mr. Musfar said, as you are aware, the statutory process laid out in the Elections Law Amendment Act number 15 of 2000, has been triggered to revise the last official list of electors. In this regard, a preliminary list of electors, the PLE, has been extracted, published, and is now the subject of a claims and objection exercise, as is mandated by the provisions of the said Act and the National Registration Act. This process is still ongoing. So that is what I was mentioning earlier, that this is not by someone whims and fancy that you come, oh, we should get a list from here, oh, we should get a list from there, and subject it to, oh, let's do a claims and objection now, oh, let's not do a claims and objection now. These are all statutory processes laid out by several laws, the election laws, and they need to be followed faithfully.
And I'm seeing that this letter is dated the 26th of October, mm-hmm. so we're now 3 business days into the week, and there has been no response. And I'm seeing in paragraph 3 mm-hmm. of this letter, it goes back to the point with the House of Registrants list not being supplemental mm-hmm. to the PLA. This is what the letter says. There, and I quote, "There is absolutely no provision in any legislation which permits or authorizes the publication of another list. The law provides for only one preliminary list of electors, compiled either from a registration exercise or from the National Register of Registrants," mm-hmm. unquote. So exactly. This is very, very clear.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This is very, very clear.
And this is all the process that's laid out in the Elections Act. So one just have to follow that process.
Yes.
There's no deviating from the process as we see is happening now. All you need to do is follow that process, and the GCOM Commission's job is to ensure that everyone follows that process and to direct the Secretariat in the way that they follow the
and
process.
They've been doing it for 5 years, for 5 election cycles.
Exactly.
I don't know what's different now.
Mm-hmm. Well, what is clear is that we need explanations. The Guyanese people need clear explanations, and that explanation should come from the GCOM chairperson herself on why these things are occurring in our country.
Mm-hmm. I agree with you 100%.
So we basically need explanations are also needed in other areas. We see, very unfortunately, continued increase in crime. Now, we did speak about this before, but prior to taking office in 2015, the AP and UAFC coalition, they boasted very vociferously of having several former law enforcement officials and top brass security experts, etc., among its ranks, and they would have promised a solution to crime in Guyana. They had promised this. I think one of it is time for better security or something like that. But in over 4 years since, crime has resoundingly escalated. And this is evidence we see in the daily newspaper. It doesn't matter which newspaper you read, whether mm-hmm. you like to read the Times or the Starbrook. It's in every
or the Chronicle.
Or the Chronicle. it's in every single newspaper. You see it online.
You're
seeing videos. Mm-hmm. You know, it's reported widely. So Guyanese, we are aware of what's going on. No one can tell us that there's not a crime situation currently in our country.
Exactly.
Now, the AP and UAFC coalition, when they would have touted their many experts and ex-military officials, etc., they had promised several things, one of which was to confront serious crimes. This was to end crime that is bleeding the lives, these are the words that they used, bleeding the lives and bodies of our women and youths and scaring away investors. So this was a problem that they had before.
Mm-hmm.
They were seeing the crime situation as hurting investment in our country.
Mm-hmm.
But one can ask the question,
where are the investors now?
Where are the investors now, one? And what is this, what is your stance on crime now?
Mm-hmm.
That is leading away our investors. They had also promised the establishment of a crime task force.
Mm-hmm.
We see that nothing is happening with that right now. They had also promised to develop, and hear this word, innovative strategies to enhance and support current police efforts to better serve the security needs of Guyana and to implement a national crime and security policy. Not done, not done. Now, when it comes to innovative strategies, we see that this government is not only, they're not innovative or creative, but they're basically doing the minimum, or they're doing nothing at all.
Mm-hmm.
A matter of fact, there have not been any official from the government that has come out and said, you know, our government has this in place to tackle crime. What we're seeing is them basically saying that there's no crime situation, and this is not what Guyanese would have voted for in 2015,
mm-hmm.
right? Basically, it's not what Guyanese voted for.
In fact, the Minister of Public Security is busy fighting to become the Prime Minister in the upcoming, the Prime Minister candidate in the upcoming elections. And
he's quite busy.
Quite busy in that regard. Busy with everything else except the crime situation and fighting the crime.
He also says there's no crimes.
Mm-hmm. Constantly. And then he blames the victims, which I have a very fundamental problem with. He goes around making statements such as, oh, you should not be walking with so much cash in your pockets that you're basically asking to be robbed and stuff like that. Rather than
completely ridiculous.
Yeah, exactly. Rather than address the issue at its core and formulating policies, as they put it, innovative strategies to fight crime. Whatever happened to
those
promises? Where are those innovative strategies?
But recently, guys, I don't know if you would have paid attention. This Sunday, you were probably busy doing something else. This Sunday, the president, David Granger, the coalition leader, there was a recorded program. Mm-hmm. It was broadcasted this past Sunday, and he made several comments during that interview.
Mm-hmm.
One of the statements, referring to crime, he said, and I quote, because I don't want to get into trouble, I'm quoting him, the crime situation is not as bad as some people make it out to be, unquote.
That is an insult to everyone in Guyana, all Guyanese, even in Guyana, outside of Guyana, because he's blatantly lying and misrepresenting the realities of what is happening here.
Well, it's showing that he's out of sync with reality. And you know what? I did watch
interview.
So the question on many Guyanese mind after hearing Mr. Granger's comments in that very rare interview.
Well, we do know his track record, and his inaccessibility to the media has been ridiculous over the past 5 years. We have basically the media has not had access to him.
Mm-hmm.
It's always, they have to speak to him at the site of some event,
mm-hmm.
and then they whisk him away in 5 seconds.
Mm-hmm.
He's also not held more than 5 press conferences over his tenure, which is unheard of
mm-hmm.
in a modern-day democratic society.
Exactly.
So his inaccessibility has really been something that Guyanese will pay attention to.
Well, this rare interview was conducted by Gordon Mosley, so
okay.
Anyways. So what was precisely said there, and what was the message for the Guyanese people in it, is we heard things like, he insisted that he created a type of government that responds to present-day challenges facing Guyanese. And he said, and I will quote like one, because we don't want to get in trouble here, is I don't like a big cabinet, I like an effective cabinet. But reality runs contrary to this, is what happened is when he took office May 2015, after the general and regional election, the size of the cabinet compared to previous government ballooned. They're the largest cabinet in the Caribbean right now.
Exactly. From they have moved from 17 ministers under the last PPC government, 17 ministers there, to now 27 ministers. Most of them are in the cabinet as well.
And most of them are ministers within a ministry
mm-hmm.
and things like that.
Exactly. Also, Nalini, in that program, they ignored the massive level of corruptions, evidenced by several exposés over the last 4 years, as viewers are aware, and constantly we have highlighted those here on the program. There are over, I think now, about 60 to 70 major scandals that we have highlighted from since 2015 when they took office that the ministers are involved in. In an outright dismissal or denial of the state of affairs by Mr. Granger, as Nalini pointed out, totally out of sync with reality, he said this, and I quote, "We need to have ministers and public officials who are incorruptible." I can agree with him there. We definitely need to have ministers and public officials who are incorruptible, but this cabal that is in government is not the ones. So,
most corrupt.
Yeah, most,
most corrupt.
And I continue. "The people of Guyana must be satisfied that their ministers are honest. I am against corruption personally. I am confident that my government is against corruption." Now, just to go over briefly some of the corruption that the most recent ones actually that have been highlighted.
Try your best to fit all of that into.
Well, I'll just go at the very recent ones and just over the 2 weeks or so.
Wow, okay.
Just 2 weeks or so. We saw that a minister, a junior minister within the Ministry of, I think she's now Agriculture, because these ministers keep moving around all the time.
To make them Yearwood,
Minister Yearwood, getting massive tracts of land in Linden. That's one. Minister Ferguson, after coming into office in pre-2015, living in a rented house, now has several plots of land with a huge mansion on it. Minister Cathy Hughes, who has a private company, and as we've highlighted on the show before, getting several contracts from various ministries, including her own ministry, including her own ministry,
making millions of dollars.
Also, Yearwood, the minister I mentioned earlier, she was moved from the Ministry of Housing because her husband was the main contractor in that ministry and getting
that
contracts.
That was how they become incorruptible, is the movement.
Exactly. We also know about the massive procurement fraud by Vonda Lawrence with Anson McCall, single sourcing drugs for twice, in some instances, three times the price that you would normally pay for it. And of course, the infamous David Patterson, who has so much scandals behind his name, and he keeps hiding from all of them. There is the scandal of the Marriott, where he took $9,000 was paid into his personal bank account by a Chinese firm. He said, oh, those monies were collected from Marriott, and I'm going to give it back to them. Of course, we have seen no evidence of any such thing. We all know what happened with the Demerara, the proposal for the feasibility study for the new Demerara Harbor Bridge, where he just took an unsolicited bid, took it to cabinet, got their approval, took the money from the Demerara Harbor Bridge company and paid it to the company.
Yes.
And of course, some monies are missing there as well, because the contract cost was one sum and the amount he took was another cost. So those are just some of the few.
Thank you.
And then we have a president that goes on air and tells the nation something like this. He's clearly out of sync with reality and clearly doesn't respect Guyanese. Yes.
He thinks they're all, I don't even want to say that.
Well said, guys, but Guyanese have also been feeling the squeeze as a result of the policies that would have been implemented by this AP and UAFC administration. Mm-hmm. And when pressed on the matter this past Sunday, this is what David Granger had to say. I quote, many people are happy, unquote, with this government. Now some questions can be asked. One, who are these people that are happy? Is it the elites in his cabal? Mm-hmm. And who is he getting these messages from?
He said he got lots of letters and cards.
Okay, but because we know that he does not visit the communities, mm-hmm. we know that every time there's a crisis, we know who are the officials that are on the ground.
Mm-hmm.
Guyanese know who are the officials that are on the ground, who is visiting region 1, 7, 8, and 9, the interior, who is in the urban areas, who is on the coastland, who is interacting with Guyanese, getting proposals for their manifesto.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we started this process a very long time ago. They have not even begun mm-hmm. to do this as yet, because we know that they're fighting for positions right now. So who are these people that he's getting these messages from? Now, what they represented, I think, was more of the same. Now, there's no vision for the future, and there's clearly an inability to detail a plan to move Guyana forward and the Guyanese people forward by this government.
To answer your question, I can tell you who are the people that are not happy with this government. In Region 5, for example, those persons living within the areas of Danzig all the way up to Fairfield, they are definitely not happy or enjoying the good life that the government keep promising everyone.
Recently, Region 3.
Region 3 as well. So what we highlighted, when you asked if we were busy on Sunday, yes, we were. The leader of the opposition, General Secretary of the People's Progressive Party, was on the ground in those communities visiting the flood-affected residents there of those areas. And what came out of that meet, those engagements, and I think it's very important that everyone should understand, is that we're not blaming the government for a natural disaster. This is by no means a natural disaster. I see a lot of people arguing, a lot of government apologists on Facebook saying that, oh, we are now blaming the government for a natural disaster. But let me point out that this is not a natural disaster. What happened was, in February of this year, the regional chairman, after he would have done some visits in the region, when he highlighted that in Danzig, there was a small breach, very small breach at the sea defenses.
Yes.
He highlighted this to the Minister of Public Infrastructure, Minister Patterson, who we spoke about earlier. So, you know, he's always busy with everything else except, dealing with what he's supposed to be dealing with. So he ignored him. It was highlighted to the MMA, ADA. They ignored it as well, and he took it to the RDC. And he was basically asking the REO to release some funds to him so that we could get this rectified before it becomes a major problem. The REO, in response, held a press conference and said that, oh, the chairman, don't bother with him. He is engaged in fear-mongering, and he's lying to the nation. Now we all see the results of this. So definitely those people are not happy with the government. It cannot be them writing to the president saying, oh, we're happy with the way you're doing things. Also, we've made it a practice of highlighting those citizens that get in contact with us and give us their problem and tell us what they're facing and their reality with dealing with this government. One such problem I'd like to highlight very quickly is the teachers, especially in Region 4 and other areas. They have been getting in touch with us and saying that their pay is constantly late. Yes. They haven't been receiving their checks and their paychecks for 3-4 days, sometimes even a week late.
Wow.
In the mail. And we know, you know, teachers
that
are
that
very...
That can cause a lot of hardships. Mm-hmm.
Especially
cause
if
a
you're
lot of hardships.
Going from paycheck to
yes.
Yeah, so I just wanted to point that out quickly that, you know, while the president go on air and say one thing, the reality on the ground is totally
yes.
different. Totally different.
Because he's all the same.
That's right. And their policies have really hurt a large section or everyone in this country in one way or another.
Except
their policies.
Their cabal,
except their cabal.
Cabal.
Now, in contrast to these policies that have really affected Guyanese people, the PBPC has been rolling out its plan for the future in phases and how this will impact youths in a major way for thousands of people in Guyana. Now, with us in studio to discuss the PBPC's plans is Mr. Vikram Bharat, PBPC parliamentarian. Good evening.
Welcome.
Thank you for being here with us.
Let me thank you for inviting me on the program. Good evening to our viewers. And I must commend you guys for doing a wonderful program, weekly program, bringing Guyanese up to date with the current news, the political situation in our country, and also exposing the corruption that is happening under the AP and UAFC government. Before I hand it back to you. Let me also commend the person who's producing this program because
yes.
I don't see her much on camera, but she's the person behind the scenes who's been doing a wonderful job. Mm-hmm. It's Vanessa.
Okay. We know that in the first phases of the rollout of the PBPC plan that Juan mentioned, there are several phases, and those phases are phase one, and you would have seen these around your communities and areas and on the highway and the road, the posters of the plan that the PP has. Also, the second phase is the launch of a reader-friendly version of the manifesto. That is yet to happen, but it will happen soon. I know that is going to be in the coming weeks or so. And of course, the last phase of everyone to understand the plan that the PBPC have for the future would be the actual launch of the manifesto containing the technical details and all of this. I know, Vic, you're one of the persons that have been working on this. So I've seen in, for example, the posters that the PBPC is promising for youths, and specifically for youths, apprenticeships and job for youths, 50,000 new jobs over the 5-year period, a chance to own your own house and land, in the form of 50,000 house lots over the 5-year period again, 20,000 online scholarships so that everyone can get themselves educated, free university within the 5-year period of first year in office, and support for small businesses with grants and interest-free loans. You care to elaborate more on these promises?
Thank you, Steve. Mm-hmm. Let me just touch on the first one, which is a very, very important issue that's affecting especially the young population in Guyana today, and that is of employment, mm-hmm. youth employment in Guyana. As a matter of fact, I've been doing a little research recently, and I believe youth employment in Guyana is at its highest since 1993,
wow.
when we would have took back government, Comrade Chedi in 1992. It is almost 25%. That's the ratio right now with youth employment in Guyana.
Mm-hmm.
It shows that the AP and UAFC government would have failed the young people in Guyana.
Definitely.
It means that we would have to do a lot of damage control come March 2020, beyond March 2nd, 2020, by creating jobs for young people first and foremost. Because young people are frustrated. Young people don't have a job. We stand the risk of losing them through brain drain. We stand the risk of youths going into crime.
Mm-hmm.
We stand the risk of youths going into other delinquent activities because they are not gainfully employed.
And we see that already happening.
We have seen these things in our society happening more frequently
exactly.
of recent. So I would say, without hesitation, that the AP and UAFC government would have failed youth in terms of providing employment. We would have heard the president asking you to go into to business, open up their own business. There is this famous one about the planting chips and the cocoa rice
exactly.
and all these things. But it is a government responsibility. We know that no government in the world can create or can provide employment for all its people. But it is the task or the duty of a government to ensure that the environment is conducive for people to enter into the private sector. And that is something that we have not seen since 2015 to date. We cannot see that when you have over 200 new additional increased taxes. We cannot see that when there is so much penalties and fines being imposed on importers and VAT and export products and all these things. The environment is not encouraging. It is not conducive for people to venture into business activities. As a result of that, we would have seen a slowdown in the economy because people who wanted to invest, young people too, people who wanted to come back to Guyana to invest, they are not inclined to do so because of the environment that was created here by the AP and UAFC government. So we need to change that.
Definitely.
We need to change that and make Guyana a country that people would see as a fertile ground to come and invest. People living in Guyana would have the kind of confidence in the government and the country to invest their money. Because when people invest, when you have investment in a country, you create employment. That is direct employment. And that is what has been missing from this country for the past 4.5 years. If we can think of any major investment outside of the oil and gas sector in Guyana since 2015 to now, I don't think we can come up with any.
In fact, even in 2015, there was oil companies were here.
The oil company was already here.
Yeah.
The oil company was already here. And since we touch on the oil, oil, you know, this is a very topical issue. And the government has been, I would like to use the word fool. They have been fooling young people, especially that the oil and gas sector would be the answers to all the problem. We have nothing against the oil and gas sector. As a matter of fact, we support the oil and gas sector. It is a new sector. It is a sector that will be good for Guyana once managed properly.
Definitely.
But we know for sure too that the oil and gas sector will not create the kind of jobs that the government are promising. It is the subsidiary businesses and the other investors that will come because of the oil and gas that will create the employment. So it comes back to the environment that this government is creating.
I like that you pointed out that unemployment is now where it was when the PP took back office since 1993. Importantly, back then, I'd like to point out for the viewers' education is when the PP took the country, then it was a bankrupt country. So he spent a lot of time building infrastructure, getting the country back on track, paying debts, and all of these things. Whereas when the AP and UAFC took office in 2015, they took a very vibrant, a steady growing economy. They had a lot of money in the treasury, a lot of money in the central banks, gold reserves, the highest it has ever been in the country. So they really have no excuse for the high level of unemployment.
Exactly, because when they took Guyana, all the productive sectors in this country, they were blooming.
Exactly.
All the productive sectors, maybe with the exception of sugar, which we were trying to keep alive because of the amount of employment that it creates, and because we know closing estates would create a number of social and welfare issues which we are being faced with right now in Guyana.
Exactly. Socioeconomics.
Right. So we might be focusing, sometimes we focus on Region 4 or Jarshung, but if you go to Borbis, people are crying out for jobs.
Yep.
There are people who cannot send their children to school because they don't have a job today.
Feed their children.
They don't have a job today. But Steve, to address the issue of how we would create employment, we have heard our presidential candidate, Stefan Ali, we have heard our general secretary, Dr. Barrett Jagdeer spoke, and I should say Dr. Irfan Ali
too. Dr. Ali.
have spoke at length at how we will create jobs. Young people today, and this is something that we must face up to, because there are many young people. I've been in Borbis over the last weekend, and we know Borbis is about sugar, about rice, about agriculture. But there are a lot of young people who may not want to venture into agriculture.
definitely.
Fair enough, we need to keep agriculture going because that is our base.
Mm-hmm.
But there are a lot of young people who are not too inclined into going into that. So what is the alternative? Guyana can be one of the main ICT hub in this particular part of the world.
Mm-hmm.
Because of our geo position, we need
exactly.
to take advantage of that.
Mm-hmm.
We just need to have stable bandwidth, and we just need to bring people to come and invest in Guyana.
I don't worry that
look at
cost.
Right, look at, for example, the call centers that we brought to Guyana.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Today, they're employing almost 5,000 young people, mainly
exactly.
young people.
Yeah, as
mainly young
those
people.
Those just out of school, and while they're doing
exactly.
university, they work
exactly.
there.
Exactly, and our intention
that.
As the new government after March 2nd is to bring more of these investors into Guyana, and not only center in Region 4, but we need to provide employment in Region 2, in the hinterland regions, in Region 10, in Region 5, in Region 6. Added to that, we know that there are other sectors that we would have to work to bring back to life.
Mm-hmm.
For example, the logging sector is almost dead.
Mm-hmm.
The Forestry Commission have been complaining about this over and over. The gold, the small miners,
small
they
miners
are punishing right
yeah.
now. You find the construction sector is also down,
mm-hmm.
since this government imposed tax on construction materials, and because of the economic downturn, it is more difficult for young people to actually access a loan from the bank.
Mm-hmm.
Because a young person trying to access a loan from the bank to build their own home, they are competing with the government to access a loan now.
Mm-hmm.
Because we know that the government is running down the commercial banks to borrow money too.
Mm-hmm.
They would have borrowed $30 billion from Republic Bank
and just sitting on
for Gaisuku
mm-hmm.
without a plan.
Exactly.
Without a plan.
Mm-hmm.
When you ask them, what are you going to do with this money? There is no plan. We have heard that most of this money have been spent. Nobody knows how it has been spent. So a young person now would have to compete with this government to access a loan from the commercial bank. When the government does that, It makes it more difficult for young people to access loans. And added to that, if you do access a loan, the interest rate will be double.
Mm-hmm.
We would have managed to bring down interest rate from 30-40% to less than 10% so that young people can access a loan to build their own home on plot of land that our government would have been awarded to them. Today, that is a difficult task for young people to access a loan.
Well, first of all, it's a very difficult task to get a house lot. And I see that the PP is promising 50,000 new house lots. So I commend them on these promises.
Yes. Yes.
And these promises, Steve, I would like to say, are realistic promises.
Mm-hmm.
We are not like the AP and UAFC. And I'm certainly sure we should examine the 100-day plan of the AP and UAFC.
Yeah,
after 4.5 years,
there
are promises there that are still not fulfilled
exactly.
after four
a
and
lot,
a half
a
years.
Lot.
Yes.
So we would have looked at these things carefully to ensure that when we make promises, we can fulfill these promises.
Yes, and to that point, Mr. Bard, I'm sure our viewers are looking at home and they're wondering. Yes, we're looking at it carefully, but we should point out that these plans and promises have already been costed, unlike the AP and UAFC. So the viewers can be assured that the different strategies and the different plans that are in place right now, they've already been costed. So when we say, for example, that we will revitalize the sugar industry, there's already an amount that is put there and a way where the money will come from, so to speak. So they know how much it will cost and where the money will come from to be able to deliver this to the Guyanese people. Do you want to talk a little bit on that as well?
Exactly. That is how the People's Progressive Party operates. We don't make wild promises. We ensure that we cost these things. We look at the reality of delivering these promises. And then we go to the people and say, all right, we are going to deliver 50,000 house lots in 5 years.
Yes.
We are not going to say, oh, we will do this in 100 days, we do this in the first day.
Yes.
Similar, before I come to the actual causes,
yes.
Similarly, our presidential candidate is on record to promising free university education.
Yeah,
but he didn't
point.
Say free university education after
right
the 2nd of March.
On March
3rd.
He did not say that.
Mm-hmm.
He said that within 5 years.
Mm-hmm.
That is being real.
Mm-hmm.
That is being real. We have heard the AP and UFC saying, oh, we will give free education. But have they said to the people when they will give free education?
They did the opposite of that, actually, because they introduced VAT on private education, which I know for a fact affected many, because it affected me. At that point in time, I was studying.
UG tuition.
And the constant increases at UG. So they did the very opposite of what they promised.
And now they're promising it again.
We do need to let our viewers know, though, that this promise is not new from the AP and UAFC. They promised this before. This is a new promise from the PPP.
Yeah.
They're now making the effort to offer free education.
Yeah, because as you said, they would have costed it and know where the money are coming from to do this.
But getting back to the costing one, I'm sure viewers would like to know where the People's Progressive Party in government would deliver these from, where will they get the money, because we have been saying that they got the foreign reserves is down by half.
Mm-hmm.
That's what we left here. We have been saying that the economy is on a downturn, definitely downturn. People are losing jobs. People might want to know, well, how will the PPP do this?
Exactly.
I would start out by saying proper management of the economy.
Mm-hmm.
Astute management of the economy. That is the first thing. Having a plan and work towards implementing that plan. Because this government is not doing that. Prioritizing is another thing.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Because let me just give you one example. This government would have took away the cash grant that we give to every school child in the country.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Once you're attending public school, you get $10,000. And that wasn't the end of it. It was supposed to increase at least up to $50,000 being the ceiling.
Yeah.
Maybe by now, the PPP being in government, it would have been $30,000, $40,000.
Mm-hmm.
So if you look at that, it would have cost the government $1.6 billion, $1.6 billion a year to do that.
Mm-hmm.
In 2018, and many of you sit in Parliament when there's budget debate, mm-hmm. in 2018, the government spent $1.4 billion, an increase, of $1.4 billion on dietary.
Excellent.
And that's food, that's eating food for conferences and meetings and drinking and all these things.
Yeah.
$1.4 billion, and that's an increase, that is not a total amount.
Mm-hmm. That's an increase on 2014 from what the
exactly,
people have spent.
Exactly,
yeah.
And that amount by itself, once it was managed properly, and a few people, as you mentioned earlier, didn't want to enjoy the good life, all Guyanese could have been benefited. All Guyanese could have benefited. So I would say proper management, prioritizing our spendings based on people's needs, creating jobs, bringing in investments, definitely.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And you need to create an environment to induce or entice investors to come to your country, not like what we have in.
Well, as we're talking about upcoming elections and promises being made, we are seeing an influence of social media, and we know IT is kind of your area of expertise. So how do you think social media, young people accessing this information, right, it kind of creates a problem when young people just live in this small social media bubble. What would be your advice to young people in order to access information in a more unbiased manner, so like break away the bubble almost?
Well, you're true. You're right about that, Nalini. Most young people these days, and some of us right here are guilty of that. We are always on our phone, on social media. And this is something that we cannot stop.
Mm-hmm.
This is something that we cannot stop. But young people need to be careful as to the type of information that they indulge their reading in,
mm-hmm.
the type of information that they would look at, the kind of details too, that some people produce at times are not what young people should be exposed to. So they need to be careful, they need to be selective, and not stick only to social media. Because I find young people now, because I've been a teacher for years too, don't read the newspapers, for example.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
That's
if you ask any young person now if they read a newspaper yesterday, I'm not sure how many would say that. I'm not sure how many would say that. I'm not sure, well, I'm hoping that there are a lot of young people looking at this program here tonight or listening to Freedom Radio 91.1 FM.
Mm-hmm.
So young people need to, like you rightly mentioned, come out of the bubble of social media alone. We're not saying come out of it totally, but come out of that and to expand their knowledge with information that is relevant and accurate.
Mm-hmm.
And young people must be able to decipher as to what is accurate information and what are false promises or people want, you know, this famous thing about fake news, so we got to be careful about fake news.
Exactly.
So they must ensure that information that they are being received is credible.
And from verified sources.
Yeah. And from good sources.
Yeah, exactly.
And I'm sure our young population now, be it how it is, the level of education, the knowledge, the exposure that we have, they are capable of doing that.
Definitely.
Differentiating the difference between...
From credible information from the fake news. I would like to see the fake news by the APN
University. In your closing remarks, as we are running out of time here on the program, if you were to compare the track record of the PPPC and the APNUA coalition, what would be your assessment in terms, we'll be dealing specifically here with youth, so we started off with the youth. So what would be your assessment in this regard?
In terms of the comparison, Steve, if you want me to answer in short, it's like chalk and cheese. But let me say that in my personal opinion, and especially with young people too, The two most significant achievements of the People's Progressive Party administration from 1992 right up to 2015 is not building all of those hospitals and schools, health centers, health posts, roads, proper drainage infrastructure, and all the other infrastructure that we would have put in place, the Warby's Bridge, the new Skellen Estate, and all these things. Those are good things, but for me, the two most important achievements of our administration was to bring back hope and democracy to this country, which would have benefited all Guyanese, especially young people, especially young people. Our brain drain in Guyana is at an unprecedented level because people would have lost hope prior to 1992. Guyanese would have lost hope in the government and the country of the day. People were running away from Guyana. That is why anywhere you go in the world, they're Guyanese. Sometimes we boast that there are more Guyanese outside of Guyana than in Guyana.
That's actually a statistic, though.
Yes, because people lost hope when the PNC were rigging elections and they were a true dictator then. And we would have restored that. And look at the difference. In 4.5 short years, this government, the APNUFC government, is taking us right back to where we were in 1992. Mm-hmm. People are beginning to lose hope again. And obviously, we don't have a democracy anymore. We have an illegal government.
Exactly.
We have a dictator, in other words. Mm-hmm. This is a total dictatorship. This is a government that doesn't respect the constitution of this country. Exactly. Mm-hmm. And what example are you sending to the young people of this country? Mm-hmm. So I want the young people to notice that the APNUAFC will come to you again In a short period of time, asking for your vote like they did in 2015. In 2015, we warned the young people, especially in this country, that voting for the APNUAFC is taking us back into dictatorship. For me, a lot of young people didn't understand what was dictatorship.
They never experienced it, right?
Right, like they didn't understand what was dictatorship. But thankful to the APNUAFC today, they're having a first-hand experience of dictatorship.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
As you saw people saying things like, well, you know, that was the old PNC.
I wasn't born then, I didn't grow up under that, I don't
understand
it, but you, as you said, you're having a first-hand experience now of what is happening.
Definitely, you know, in 2015, the whole thing was about change, and as Mr. Barrett rightfully said, you know, we did warn a lot of young people, and I want to warn them once again, because next year will determine our future. Next year will determine whether you have a government in place that cares about you, that cares about your future, whether you have access to the banks, whether you have a well-paying job, whether you will get a land, you get an opportunity to build a house. Next year determines a whole lot. Don't take a chance and gamble with your vote again next year. Ensure you put your X next to a party, the PPPC, that will give you and your family a bright future.
Okay, Mr. Barrett, since we still have you, would you like to say anything in your closing remarks, specifically to the viewers, the youth that are looking, and in fact, everyone that's looking?
Definitely. Besides from thanking you guys for having me on the program, let me encourage all Guyanese, to get on the voters list. If you are not on the voters list, you don't have a say. If you are not on the voters list, you cannot determine or you don't have a say as to who will govern your country in the next 5 years. The opportunity is now to ensure that you're registered and you're on the voters list. This period would end on the 4th of November, which is next Monday. So we just have a few days more. So we are encouraging people to go to these offices on the East Bank here, if I may say. There is one at Eccles Primary School, one at Covent Garden Primary School, one at Diamond, that is right next to DDL, one at Friendship Secondary School, one at Supply Primary School. There is a Suzyk Center right next to the NDC at the junction, and then there's the Yarra-Kabra Center on the highway. So for those of us on the East Bank, let us ensure that we go and conduct our transactions, not only new registration, but transfers, because we know there are a number of new housing schemes on the East Bank. People, please ensure that you go and you take a transfer and you vote wherever you're living.
No. Thank you for being here today. Thank you for the fruitful discussion. Hopefully you come back before elections to talk some more about youths. And thank you for the East Bank elaboration on the elections there. So I would like to remind our viewers that you can find our program on our Facebook page, This Week in 60 Minutes, where you can watch it or rewatch it at any time and share with a friend. For any questions or so, you can message the page or contact us on our page, as well as please remember to pick up your copy of The Mirror, where you'll get all the content we've discussed and more.
And remember, final reminder, we can't stress this enough, the claims and objections period is ending on November
4th. Please don't go over all the centers.
Please, I'm not going to go over the centers, but I'm saying get out there, ensure you do your transfer, ensure you get registered. If you'll be 18 by December 31, 2019, ensure your name is on the list, you're in the right district. Do what it takes, because your vote is important next year. So we're urging Guyanese voters to ensure that their name is published on the preliminary list of electors, and it is available. This list is available on GCOM's website, which is gcom.org.gy. You can then click on the PLA and you can search using the ID card option there on the website. Also, the printed preliminary list of electors is posted within your polling areas. Also, it is available on our Facebook page should you need it.
The link is on our Facebook page.
Oh, and the link as well is on our
Facebook
page.
The link is right here.
Visit This Week in 60 Minutes. To get the link.
Okay, I'd just like to give a quick conclusion of what we've discussed here. So the main points coming out from GCOM is that the main takeaway should be that the GCOM chairman needs to explain these decisions that she has been taking. The public need answers, and I think she is the one that needs to provide these answers to the public. The other thing is we have highlighted how is it that Mr. Granger is out of sync with reality, totally out of sync with reality, saying one thing, which is in our view, basic disrespect for the citizens of this country, blatantly lying to us, basically. We had a very young PPC parliamentarian, Mr. Vikram Bharat, where he spoke about the youths and the problems that the youths are facing and how the PPC intends to curb these problems and what their plans are for a new PPC government in office and what they plan to do specifically for youths. He also mentioned that youths are a major part of the PPC plan heading into the future. Of course, that is by no stretch of anyone's imagination. The PPC had some of the youngest ministers, in cabinet ministers, as a matter of fact, in any government. We have a very young presidential candidate. So I'd just like to say thank you for being with us for the last hour or so. We hope you join us next week as we continue our discussion. Good night and see you all.
Thank you.
Get registered.
Yes.